Let's turn now to the current association agreement. The Ukrainian parliament just approved a new EU association agreement. How does that differ from the previous one, which was then rejected by former President Yanukovych? Or is it basically the same?
Of course there are differences, and I don't think we will get into the details of the association agreement. But I do think that the significance of events over the past months has been to change the appetite in the European Union to engage in a significant way with Ukraine. As I mentioned, that in the run-up to the East Vilnius summit last November, there was even a question of how many European heads of state were going to go to that summit. And a lot of people felt that the association agreement was actually a way to prevent Ukraine from joining the EU. It was one of those way stations, well, let's negotiate this with them, because there wasn't a large desire in the EU for enlargement. You know, we have this phrase, enlargement fatigue, that because the EU has enlarged so much over the past 25 years, there's a need to actually digest those new members before they take on yet more commitments. And the actions that Russia has taken has changed the resolve in the EU. So you now see consensus among EU member states to engage and support Ukraine and help Ukraine get onto a more sustainable economic and political path. So I think it's that larger context that is important when we think about how Ukraine's relationship to the EU is developing over time, even if this is perhaps on a longer timeline. It's not going to happen tomorrow, but the outlines of Ukraine's developing relationship to the EU have become much clearer over these past months.
Now, turning to Ukraine itself, Karen, there are many challenges. Ukraine is not perfect. It's not good versus evil. There's been a lot of corruption in Ukraine, and many reforms need to be undertaken, notwithstanding, of course, the challenges faced by Ukraine by these separatists, Russian-backed separatists, and much aggression. What are your thoughts with regard to how they are in the process of meeting these challenges, of making these important economic reforms, even though they're under siege in a sense? Mm-hmm. We are looking at upcoming parliamentary elections later in October. Do you think Ukraine is stepping up to the plate as much as it can under the circumstances?
You were right in outlining all of the challenges Ukraine faces. This has been an incredible year for Ukraine that's included tragedy, it's included some successes. I think Ukraine has moved forward quite dramatically on the democratic path. And when you think about first the election of President Poroshenko, that you actually had a free and fair election in a country that is facing the crisis Ukraine is facing. And yes, they couldn't have that election in all parts of the country, but to the extent that you were able to allow Ukrainians to voice their choice, it was a huge exercise in democracy that I would applaud. And you're right, we're now moving toward parliamentary elections. You had Ukraine sign an IMF standby agreement, which includes conditionality and important reforms that Ukraine has to put into place. And I do believe the current government is wholly committed to that, because for them, it's the path to economic health. So huge challenges, yes, but I think we've seen a concomitant commitment on the part of the current government. And I think what's driving this is when Ukrainians look around them, they look at, for example, Poland, and say, this is a country that 25 years ago did not look that different than Ukraine. Mm. And Ukraine may even have been a bit ahead of Poland economically. And you look, compare them today, and because of the choices Poland made and its membership in the EU and NATO, it is in a very different and far better position politically and economically than Ukraine is. And I think that's what a majority of Ukrainians want to have the right to choose and to work toward.